Sridhar. Our master of ceremonies is very good. We are bang on time. I was supposed to begin at 8:30 and there we are. Ladies and gentlemen, may I first of all thank all of you for being here this evening. Some of you have come from a long way, Gurgaon, Noida and so on a winter Saturday evening where you could have been doing other things, and I am very grateful. Next, my thanks obviously to Uday Upendra, who conceived this idea, organized it. I tried to dissuade him. There are enough village station functions happening. In February alone, there were 6. There are 5 in March, so program associations are doing it. So why do you take on the bother and the expense of doing it? But he was very insistent that he had a number of friends in different functions, in management, in the corporate sector, and all I had to do was to consent. And of course, in all these felicitations, you have to sing a little bit for your supper. And I'm delighted to do that. My wife always keeps telling me, don't speak too long. But I love talking if I have a podium. So when he asked me for the topic, I suggested that I'd love to speak on the mission and vision of Indian professional management. That's a huge theme. It is an audacious subject on which to talk for any one person. But let me give you some earlier examples. My original institute, the Institute of Cost Accountants, where I began qualifying in 1961 in Calcutta, they held their 55th annual convention in Bhubaneswar on 23rd February. And they called me and gave me, is there any cost accountant here in the group? Well, we have a chartered and cost together there, very good. They gave me an award called the Icon of the Profession. There I spoke about the mission and vision of the Indian Cost and Management Accountant. What this profession can contribute to the cost competitiveness of India globally in reducing imports as well as in expanding exports, how we should eventually run up a surplus like Germany, Japan and China from the current account deficits that we are now experiencing. On 15th March in Gurgaon, the National Institute of Personnel Managers is felicitating me. They are holding their Foundation Day and they asked me to give the Foundation Day lecture, and there I am speaking on the mission and vision of the Indian personnel management profession, which obviously is different from that of cost accountants. Similarly, if I were to meet the marketing group, I'd like to focus on that function. Here, it's a multifunctional general management, top management group. Therefore, I'm speaking on the total umbrella of professional management. Let me first give a little bit of my background, what qualifies me even to raise this subject with you. I identified this life mission of management, as was mentioned in the introduction, in 1960. I was 19. I was just completing a BSc in statistics with commerce and economics as ancillary subjects at the Lila College, Chennai. And I came to the conclusion that I should devote my life to helping India build a management profession, which didn't exist at that time except a few multinationals, and even they were very much under control from the West. For example, in Swinkline Beecham, every ad and label had to be cleared from Brentford before it could go onto the market here. A profession has 3 things, 3 key defining characteristics. First, there is a body of knowledge, and at that time there were no institutions in the country to offer this body of knowledge. We had to go back to Harvard Business School, which began in 1906, and several other schools in US. Even Europe did not have business schools at that time. So what is knowledge? Second is the skills to apply that knowledge. As a culture, we are better at accumulating knowledge and not so good at skills in every field. This is one of the criticisms of IITs, for example. They produce very good theoretical engineers but not good on the shop floor, which I'm sure Pradeep and many others have talked about. And sometimes it is more frustrating to work with a highly knowledgeable person who wouldn't actually do things. So you go back to diploma holders and so on, which is all right, which has its place. And the third is values. And you know that there have been several issues of different magazines in the country last 5 years which have talked about the high skills of the Indian medical profession and the huge gap in values of that profession. for example, several unnecessary surgeries, one of the most common being cesarean. And similarly, other, my cardiologist who has run 100 marathons tells me, don't go near a hospital. They want to put you into the operation theater. Go and do exercise and take care of your diet. Now, why did I come to this conclusion? 1947, I was a very proud school student celebrating the Independence Day. I have very clear memories of it. At that time, India had achieved three or four things, which were very good. Despite the cost of British rule, there were positive sides to it. We had achieved political independence. We were way ahead of the African countries and other parts of Asia. We were the first major post-war country to gain independence. Second, we had inherited democratic institutions, which is a big problem now. Despite the Arab Spring from Tunisia, Egypt, and so on, these countries have great difficulty building democratic institutions. What are these institutions? We had a parliament. 1952, I remember the very exciting election, campaigning, people on bicycles in every constituency. The world was watching with amazement at the Indian Lok Sabha elections. Judiciary, Pakistan, Iftikhar Chowdhury has done some improvements there, but they didn't sustain that institution, but we have an outstanding judiciary. We have to help them expand and take care of the backlog. We also inherited a civil service, armed forces, which were very disciplined and under civilian rule, no question of a military takeover. The big vacuum was in business management. So we had democracy, parliament, judiciary, armed forces, civil service, but we didn't have managerial community. So that's why I thought this was necessary. From 1967 to 2014, now 37 years, my every breath and my interest, my primary commitment has been to rural management, and I have caused a lot of frustration to my wife, arguing every time where we have to go to a party, attend a wedding, some social event or the other. One doesn't have the time. These are all luxuries, but one has to do some of that. The first decision, which was very clear in my mind, is that although I qualified from Stanford and Harvard, and there were job opportunities, and there were some other Indians who did that PhD along with me, I was the only one who came back to India, because I had already made the decision, as they mentioned. There was no doubt that India was my Kabhumi. And I tried to be, although Rajiv's poem is very kind and it exaggerates, I have tried to be a management missionary, an evangelist, long before Bill Gates used that term for software. I've been a management evangelist, and I think everywhere I have faced skepticism, and people have considered me a bit of a bottle, but I've always been optimistic, looking at the glass half full, and changes necessary and possible in every sector. So one of the things I can look back with some satisfaction, although the award comes late, is the sheer satisfaction of the job done, bringing management ideas into all sectors, to begin with the private sector, which was ready in the 1970s, PSUs in 1980s, back to private sector after liberalization in 1991, where the government rediscovered Indian entrepreneurship. Between 1947 and 1990, the relationship between Indian government and business was adversarial. It was ideological. It was partly based on the Soviet system. So the decline in the growth rate and 3% average forced us to reckon. China has great difficulty building its entrepreneurship. Part of it is party, PLA, crony capitalism. But we have genuine generations of Indian entrepreneurs who are now taking charge. And in the multinationals, Indian managers are emerging as the intrapreneurs, not only building Indian business, but Indian products are going in Unilever to Latin America, in Pepsi, all over the world. So things are happening here. I'm grateful to many internal change agents who have made it possible for me to do this, because Sarangi was here earlier, Indian Oil Corporation. I remember his excitement in 1980. I came back from UK and Europe in 1978. 1980, I was speaking at the ISTD convention in Bhopal. I gave a paper on a model similar to the metrics that you looked at, strategic management and organization development, a 2x2 relationship, what happens. And very few Indian companies were able to blend good strategic thinking with good people development. There were many with good plans but poor implementation. And the public sector had lots of talent but no strategic direction or autonomy for the managements. I think India today has probably the world's largest human capital available to any nation. Management human capital. Not only in technology, software and so on, but qualified managers. When we had two institutes in India, people thought MBAs will not get jobs, and I faced a lot of skepticism. Now there are over 1,000, that's too many. In every industry there will be overexpansion, shakeout, and the good ones will survive. This human resource, human capital that we have is still underutilized. Some of it we have exported, which we can't afford. China is getting back what they call PRCs, People's Republic Returnees, to China. We should get much more of them back here. And I hope the next government will create the kind of environment. But although we have come this far in management ideas and qualification, we still have a long way to go. And I'd like to just mention a few of them. We have to get back to high growth. The Indian economy needs 20 years of about 10% per annum growth without inflation. The Economist has argued quite rightly from their point of view that the Indian economy's maximum growth rate possible is only 7%. Anything above 7% will cause inflation. And the problem is a supply chain management problem. It is not a demand problem, it is not a purchasing power problem. It is a management problem from the raw material, logistics, manufacturing, processing, packaging, marketing, exports. So it is not a bureaucratic problem or a planning commission issue. It is a micro corporate level issue. We also need to make this growth inclusive. We have 300 million population under the age of 25. We talk about a demographic dividend. It could also become a bomb, time bomb of unemployment, unrest, and street violence. So we have to have a job-creating kind of growth, and it has to be sustainable. The global compact, climate change issues. India is in danger of having the largest number of climate refugees. There's a new category of refugees, not political, not military, but the water levels in the sea is rising, Himalayas eroding, Ganga drying up. So whether or not the others in the world do it, we have to take care of our, and China is bigger on this process of green growth. One major weakness in India, government as well as the private sector, with honorable exceptions, is project management. And this is a high cost weakness, underutilization of capital, time and cost overruns in most projects. And some few examples, exceptions like Reliance, amazing. In this country, how to put a 38 million ton refinery in one place, we have done it. And some of the ultra mega power projects which are coming up. But I think the rail corridor that we are now building, urban townships which we are developing, there's a huge challenge in project management and operation. Before I come to the professional management vision, I would like to look at a broader national vision for India. India to emerge as a positive force in the world for peace, equity and values. Not interested in being superpower, which Ramchandra Guha quite rightly has said, not the largest military, not even the highest per capita income, that will be disastrous for India. We will ruin our environment with a 1.2 billion population. But a country which is strong enough, economically and militarily, but will use that strength for peace, global equity and justice. We should be arguing international fora, not for our problems, but for people even worse than we are in Africa and elsewhere. And in the midst of a moral crisis, values crisis, which people from Gorbachev downward have talked about, we should stand for values and ethics. The world already admires and goes back to Gandhiji and his thoughts, yoga, meditation, and so on. Whereas in the meantime, in our march into capitalism, we are losing some of our values. They're all there, we have regained them. One of the things in my citation, why I am being given this Padma Bhushan award, is that I have been among the pioneers trying to link Indian philosophy, spirituality and modern management. About 20 years ago, this was unacceptable. This was not politically correct. You could not talk about it in public fora. Now I think there is a higher degree of self-confidence self-assertion and willingness to look at what can we learn. Now, for the Indian professional management community, which is thousands of people around the country, hundreds of corporations, levels of managers, I'm talking about E9 in the public sector, E1, and a similar kind of job pay in the private sector. So let me just read out this mission. I would have liked a half-day workshop. You will have lots of questions. As you know, a mission has to be sculpted. Every word can be debated and discussed, but I can only offer you a draft of the vision, that mission. I start with mission, and mission itself, there is often some confusion. Mission is about the task. What's our core task? What's our purpose? What are we here to do? Vision is the future. If we do this mission right, where will it take us? Where do we want to reach? So let me take mission. To help all Indian citizens, that's 1.2 billion and growing, all Indian citizens and organizations, two targets, two customers. Every citizen, including man, woman, child, of all age groups, and all kinds of organizations, business, government, non-profit. I have with me here Mr. Jyoti Sagar, who has been with me in the Sampradan Indian Center for Philanthropy, and he has taken over as president of it after I left and became a mentor. And we have also with us here Dr. Jitendra Agarwal, a qualified doctor who went blind, and he has sublimated his difficulty by starting an organization called Sarthak, which helps people with disability. And he has a target of getting 20,000 people placed with proper training and number of corporates supporting him around the country. And I think these are people who, and the thing I can bring to him is management ideas and concepts. To help all Indian citizens and organizations in different sectors with the optimal, the key word here is optimal, some kind of management will take place. Things will move on. Muddle along. Most management, including our best companies, are still below the optimum that is potential. That's possible. And that's the whole idea of planning, reviews, and further innovation. With the optimal management processes, I think Narayanamurthy and many others are right. It is not just the technology and so on. The process is the final issue. If the process is right, a product will be right. And the Indian mindset is indiscipline. We lack process discipline everywhere, from the queue at the airport, at the buffet, everywhere, driving, and so on. So we need to optimal management processes in order to continuously enhance their respective, everybody as stakeholders. The man, the woman, the child, teacher, principal, everybody as stakeholders. So they need to become aware of the stakeholder model of management and how to continuously enhance the value and satisfaction. Now, if you do this mission right, I would like to offer a vision for Indian professional management community to help India emerge as a leading economy and society. I would put the stress more on society than on the economy. We don't need to compete with China, Japan, EU on GNP. It has to be adequate, but we have to be a leading society in the world, the most diverse, with the highest level of tolerance, acceptance, celebration of diversity, with superior macro and micro management. We are the most difficult country to manage in the world. China can crack the whip, it can control the web, it can put people in prison. India is the hardest country to run, and we need both management process in government as well as Indian urban management, for example. Why is it so hard for us to build a Shanghai? Because Bombay already exists there, and you have huge slums and constraints of land and so on. So you cannot build three gorgeous dam and clear 6 million people out of the way. Everything will go to the Supreme Court. Macro management through inclusive sustainable growth, that's the vision. I'd just like to conclude with a very quick action plan. One of the participants in the IMCA felicitation, who is not here, said that the one thing he liked about all my speeches he has listened to, I always conclude with an action plan. Yeah? Okay. Every Indian professional manager to percolate management competencies into his family, social groups and community. Every Indian organization to enhance the management competence of all its partners in the value chain from raw material to the finished product disposal. all management-related professional associations not to have destructive competition, but to work together and help improve the management in local, urban, state, national governments and agencies. The Indian professional managers to learn from global management as well as contribute to it. And every Indian manager to be a role model for contemporary management knowledge, and skills and values. Well, I know it is taking a little longer than was allotted to me. I couldn't restrain myself. I hope these ideas are useful. And each of you will carry it and multiply. I need to write about it. And the millions out there to reach. But I think this could be like Swami Vivekananda's initial group of apostles. Thank you very much today again for organizing this function. I am very grateful. Thank you.